you know, it's okay with God to live this. This is going on. So they got some weird stuff going on. And this is the neighborhood Abraham was coming into. God, is this what, this ain't what you, what is? So, a lot of times when you see your promise, you may want to think about backing out. Back out of here. Oh, wait a minute, something's going on here. Okay. So Abraham, verse 6, and the Canaanites was then in the land. That's what I mean by the Canaanite, not just the nationality, but the, this is what their lifestyle is. Almost lost. Okay, all right. You better go into 2 Peter 2 and 7. Maybe you understand where I'm coming from. To see the how disturbed these guys was. I mean, how disturbed Abraham was. And his the people that was with him.
Brother Williams.
Yes, ma'am.
I have a question.
Okay.
This is a deep one.
Go.
Why would God remove Abraham from his idols, his family, and all that corruption, and then take him into a situation
this mess.
Like that?
Why? I think it may have been a test of his faith for that as well, because you had to trust that God was going to, if he's going to put me here, he's going to fix this stuff.
Okay. Let's see how they felt about moving into that neighborhood. 2 Peter 2:7. Someone read that if you would. Verse 7 through verse 8. Verse 9. I got the answer to Sister Hills. I mean, I don't think I might be close to her answer. Anybody got that?
Verse 7.
Uh-huh.
And deliver just lie, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked, for that righteous man dwelling among them, in seeing and hearing, vexed his righteous soul from day to day with the unlawful deeds.
Verse 9.
The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptation and to reserve the unjust to the day of judgment to be punished.
Okay, so here's the neighborhood they moved into. Lot was a righteous man. So, you know, Lot was a terrible act, but he was a righteous man. Remember, Abraham converted people that was traveling with him. And Lot's been converted, but the Bible says he was vexed. Kind of like if they moved next door to Sister Hill and start parking across the yard and then putting the cars up on the holding it up with the jack in the driveway and all spots all over the place. Sister Hill would like, she'll just like him, she'll just love him. But she'd be what? Vex. So, Vex. So here's Lot, Vex. With the filthy conversation of the wicked. For that righteous man dwelling among them and seeing and hearing, what did it do? Vexed. What do we mean by vexed, Sister Hill? What are we talking about? Vexed his righteous soul from day to day, every day.
Frustrating.
Living like that. Showing that to me. Showing that man, oh boy, I went and walked the river walk going across the bridge one day. Guess what we saw? Two men in voice and just smacking at them. Woo! Vex my soul. So, that's what it says. It vexed his soul. It made him uncomfortable. My neighborhood I'm living into. So the Lord knows how to deliver me out of that. Although he called them into that land, here's the neighborhood I'm in. So I just wanted you guys to see that it wasn't so super smooth. It was some tough living. Okay. All right, we're going to go back again to Genesis, the 12th chapter again. Okay. Now, verse 7, the Lord appeared unto Abram and said, unto thy seed will I give what? This land. You think it was anything attractive about that land? It had to be something attractive about it. Worthwhile for Abraham to say, it's a worthwhile place to be, but look at the people. Look how they live. Look what's going on here. Selling, buying and selling, doing all that. Ooh, man.
It was also a fertile land.
federal agenda.
Yeah, because remember when the children of Israel, left Egypt, that's where they were going.
That's where they were going.
Yeah, they were going. Land of milk and honey.
And land of milk. It's prosperous.
Yeah, absolutely.
Market, metropolitan, everything's happening here.
It's happening.
Put New York City to a shame.
Yes.
But the lifestyle.
Oh,
okay. So, and the Lord appeared unto Abraham and said, until I see what I give this land, until I see what I give this land, and there built he an altar unto the Lord, who did what? Appeared. So we want to know how Abraham got his revelation is by appearing. God appeared. He didn't have the Holy Ghost where he could get an unction, an inclination or something like that. He took a visitation. The Lord appeared unto Abraham. So, the word altar, it's a place of worship and sacrifice. A place of worship and sacrifice. You just find that in Genesis 4, 3 and 4, Genesis 8 and 20. Abraham, there's nothing new to Abraham. This is what he wanted to do all along, was to worship. So Abraham knows how to build an altar who appeared unto the Lord, who appeared unto him. And here we move from this, from here, unto a mountain on the east of Bethel, pitched his tent, having Bethel on the west and Hanan on the east, and there he built an altar unto the Lord. He traveled just a little bit more. As he travels and he's surveying, he is building more worship places. He's building more worship places. He probably, let's say like this, bring it forward to 2012, he probably put a church next to the gatehouse.
You
probably put a family center next to the gatehouse. Something like that. He's staking his claim. He's showing the contrast. Now, also remember, Abram, the man, he is business inclined. He knows about business. And all during all of this, guess what he is doing? Increasing. He's increasing. You can't use all this for you, Abraham. Who's it going to be for? My family coming up behind me. How many kids you got, Abraham? Abram? How many you got? How many?
Zero.
They probably said, this is the craziest man we ever seen in our lives. 75 years old. And he's buying up property left and right, going on talking about his kids. Faith makes you look kind of crazy, though. So walking out there. So he's increasing the more. He ain't losing. He's increasing. What's all this for, old man? For my kids. Making preparation for my kids. Okay, here we go. Verse 9, and you pop right at verse 9, and as the Bible says, and Abraham journeyed going on till toward the south, read verse 10, he had to detour. He had to come off of his track of going through the land because the economy got bad. Verse 10 shows you that. What did it say there? And there was
a famine
in the land.
Abram went down into Egypt.
Okay, to what? Stay there for a while. Better economy. Sometimes God's got you on your track, but sometimes you got to be smart enough to do what? Make adjustments. Don't mean I'm abandoning, but I'm making an adjustment. I stay here, I'm going to start there. These folks ain't got no money to buy this stuff. I'm selling this stuff left and right, making me money. The economy's bad. Guess where else? I'm going to Egypt right now, just for a little while.
Think his famine could have been a test of his
faith? Sure. And then the famine was grievous work in the land. So God, see, the economy is bad in that land, but you don't have to be on the bad economy. God can tell you to go this way and avoid the what? Bad economy. Don't fight it. Don't try and deal with it. Do something different. For a while. What does it say there? Verse 11, what does it say? Well, okay, that's how he got into Pharaoh's house. That's how that story goes. But I just wanted you to know that he did leave off of his travels, went down to Egypt, not to travel through Egypt. God didn't promise him Egypt. He just parked it there for a little while.
I sometimes wonder how he got that kind of faith, because people that in this day and time come up against that situation. God, you told me to do this, and now what are you talking about? You told me to do that now? Or what?
Well, there's some difficulties arise. Uh-huh. God gives us what? A brain to what? Figure it out.
Yeah, but if he hadn't been walking in faith, he said, well, wait, God, you promised me this land. Why am I going over there?
But did God tell him to go into Egypt? No. But he was he's got the mind to say, you know what, we can't stay here right now like this in these travels. We're going down to Egypt into a better economy. Then we'll come back.
But see, God didn't tell them to go in Egypt. And I always wonder, remember they were in Egypt, what, 300 some year, a long time.
Okay.
And I always wondered, if he had not gone through Egypt, would they have been in the Egypt that long time?
Well,
I know it was in the plan. You know,
he went to Egypt. But Abraham was not that bunch that went into Egypt under captivity. Abraham went there as a free man, just walking it here for a little while. Then he went back to his servant. He didn't stay.
I don't think God appeared to him going to Egypt. But remember, you said that blessings was guidance.
Yeah.
So God was guiding him all the time.
You think God could have guided himself more than that? Avoid that economy, come on down here and hang for a minute, and then come on back when the economy gets back.
But you know, sometimes God guides us, and we don't heed his guidance.
That's true.
And he'll tell us to go a certain way.
Yeah.
And we'll detour.
Well, Abraham knew that the land of promise. He knew what the promise was. It's over here. The economy's bad.
Yeah.
Can't keep all these people here. I can't feed them. Let's go down to Egypt for a minute.
Was he not operating in faith when he went to Egypt?
I think he was operating in business acumen.
That's what I'm saying. Because if he had been operating in total faith,
he'd stay where he was. But he came on back, because that's how the promise was going to be fulfilled. But he did leave off of his journey and said, we're going down to the south, because, you know, look at all these people. Now, you can see it's just a little bit alluded to the fact that Abraham's kind of weak-kneed in faith by the trouble he got Sarah into.
Well, see, that's why was challenged.
He's kind of weak-kneed.
He was challenged so much
in
his faith.
Yeah.
And he was challenged even when he offered up his son.
Uh-huh.
And God said he wanted to see if he was willing to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So he was challenged all the way.
Like we are. He was like we are today. Yeah.
He wants to know if he's willing to.
No man is going to be smooth. I know big tests coming to you.
Oh, boy.
All right, God bless. I didn't mean to take us to
big testing, you know.